Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Purdy Insurance. Visit Purdy Insurance on Market Street in Sunbury or visit online at purdyinsurance.com. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Yes, they have people that'll be right there in the phones for you. And not only that, you can go to the website, purdyinsurance.com. They'll find you the right insurance, best price when available, and their customer service is second to none. Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. We're in the Sunbury Motors studio, Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors, Kia Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. That service department open from 7 to 4 Monday through Friday. 7 to 4 Monday through Friday for the great service department. And don't forget, the website is a very helpful resource for shopping and researching your vehicles. All right? That is going to be a great resource for you as well, especially with it. Interest rates so low. All right. Time now for our play-by-play call of the day. Odell Beckham Jr. against the Cowboys.
He's the running back. Play action. And Manning's going to heave one. There's a flag. Beckham, one-handed catch. How in the world?
Oh, my goodness.
And Brandon Carr was back there. I mean, he is insane. How do you make that catch?
Oh, my goodness. This is sick. Put this to music. I don't think he stepped out either. That may be the greatest catch I've ever seen.
Number 39. Penalties decline. Result of the play. Touchdown.
You have to be kidding me. That is impossible.
Yeah. It was. It's also, I think, might be the last great catch he's made. But, I mean, still.
You're exactly right.
Oh, boy. That's our play-by-play call of the day. By the way, tonight on Eagle 107, starting at 7 o'clock, great game from the past. It's Roy Halladay's perfect game against the Marlins.
Oh, that's sweet. Sweet, sweet, sweet.
Yeah.
Why wouldn't you want to relive that one?
Well, if you're a Marlins fan, they both are pretty upset about it.
Yeah, I'm going to say, oh,
are there any Marlins fans, really?
Oh, there was one once, but he moved.
That is such the entire South, but Florida Marlins is the Miami Marlins especially, they are the most fraudulent professional sports fan base I think I've ever seen. Which is fine. I mean, they're all college sports based out, you know, crazy down there, which is fine, but it's you look at Tampa Bay Rays and what they've had to deal with that bad dome that they're in, and they can't even sell out their crowd when they're in playoff games and the World Series. The Marlins built that brand new stadium. They have two people in it. You know, Atlanta, they can't fill a stadium when the Falcons are in the NFC title game in the Super Bowl. I can go on and on here about how fraudulent the South is with their professional sports.
They love Alabama and Georgia football.
Exactly. Right, and so. Tennessee. Yeah. That's it. That's all they care about, yeah. Which is fine, but that's all they care about.
And NASCAR. Look, this is what. It's actually. When I teach my class, I try to not just get up there and say, hey, I think you should do it this way and this way. No. Okay? They hand in projects, and we get into certain elements on the projects. But I try to talk to them about more than just that. And one of the first lessons I give them in the class is that when you do get a job, you have to check in your own personal preferences at the door, and you have to adapt yourself to the area. Every area is different. So I said, okay, show me. There's many of the people I have in the class happen to be from the eastern part of the state. Not all, but many are. And I said, how many of you are Flyer fans? And a series of hands went up. I said, what do you get a job in Albuquerque, New Mexico? I said, are you going to be talking about the Flyers? I said, you can't. I said, people in New Mexico don't care about the Flyers unless the Flyers are in the Stanley Cup final and your affiliate, say you're an NBC affiliate, happen to be carrying the games. But on an everyday basis, you may be interested in living and dying with the Flyers every day, and you're aching to talk about it with somebody. I said, I strongly suggest Twitter or Instagram to do that. I said, because in Albuquerque, New Mexico, or Santa Fe, wherever it may be, I said, you're not going to be talking about them on the air. You're going to be talking about New Mexico basketball, Mountain West football. New Mexico is the balloon capital of the world. They've got a huge balloon festival there every year. I said, that's what you're going to be talking about. You have to ingrain yourself into what the local preferences are. So now let's flip it to the South. In the South, they love their college football. Love it. In the South, they love NASCAR. They love it. There's been more and more interest in college basketball in recent years. If you go to Kentucky, they're absolutely ingrained in college basketball. More so than college football in Kentucky. Major League Baseball, yeah, they like college baseball. They love it. Major League Baseball, you know, Florida has a lot of transplants. All right, so that's why when you have so many transplants in Florida, you're loaded up with Orioles fans, Yankees fans, Red Sox fans, Tigers fans, Indians, Phillies fans, right? Because that's where they decide to go. So I'm going to move. It's nice and warm there. So that's why there aren't Rays fans. There aren't Marlins fans. Even though the Marlins have now been there since, what, 1993? And Tampa Bay, what was their first year, 97?
Sounds about right, yeah.
I mean, in
20
theory,
years, basically.
In theory, it's good, right? In theory. But the reality is, even over a period of two decades, you haven't been able to develop a fan base. I mean, it may take a little bit longer to do. I'll give you a perfect example of the split at Penn State when it comes to the Big Ten. Penn State has now gone through, what, 27 seasons of Big Ten football?
Mm-hmm.
Okay? All right? If you are an older fan, you still, in some ways, pine for the days of playing Pitt every year, West Virginia, Syracuse, Boston College, West Virginia, right? There's a segment of the fan base that still wishes that was part of the schedule. If you go into my class and you see a group of 18 to 23-year-olds, the Big Ten is all they know. Even though the Marlins and the Rays do have some fans that are 18 to 23 and all they know are Rays and Marlins baseball, baseball, for whatever reason, is not a sport that grabs the younger fan. And not only that, if you're growing up in a household, Matt, is your father a big Phillies fan?
He actually wasn't a sports fan at all until I came along, and then he's now a big Eagles fan like me. And football is basically like his only sport.
Right. I mean, you know, your parents do influence who you root for. Right? No, there's no getting around it. I mean, my three sons, I got one living in Virginia, one living in New Hampshire, and one living up in upstate New York. Guess what? They all like the Red Sox. Now, why? Because I like the Red Sox.
That's good parenting on your part. That's what I'm trying to pass on to Luke, except the Eagles.
Now, you're poisoning the poor kid. But
Lisa would agree.
But, I mean, so parents, so in other words, you grew up down there, but your family moved from New York and they're big Mets fans. Right? Even though the Rays and the Marlins are down there, you may become a Mets fan because of it. I mean, so it's all, I mean, and that's the problem, that's a big problem they've had. Because a lot of sports have deep-seated fan bases, and those deep-seated fan bases go back decades. And it's difficult sometimes to break that cycle. And the Marlins haven't been able to do it. The Rays haven't been able to. I think the Braves have a fan base now. I mean, they've been in Atlanta since 1966. So they've got a fan base. I think the Texas Rangers do now. The Astros do. I think, believe it or not, the Arizona Diamondbacks do. But it's so hot down there. I mean, you got to play indoors.
Yeah, most of them are in the pool and in the outfield anyway.
Yeah.
Can you blame them?
By the beer taps.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, this is the NHL. The NHL, which is such a fan-centric sport, has spread the sport out because, look, population-wise, they're trying to get into media markets and they're trying to get into population centers. And, I mean, the Florida Panthers and the Carolina Hurricanes both struggle attendance-wise.
Not a lot of ice rinks down in Charlotte, that's for sure.
No, and the Arizona Coyotes struggle attendance-wise. But the Dallas Stars do okay.
Yeah.
Nashville Predators do really well. They do really well. I mean, you wouldn't expect that. I mean, that's one of those, like, wow. And believe it or not, the Tampa Bay Lightning do okay.
Well, they put on a good product. I think that really helps as well.
They're the best pro sports franchise down there right now.
Yeah.
But the Tampa Bay Rays are a good team, though, Matt, as you pointed out. Yeah. The Rays are good. And the Rays still can't get traction, even though they're good. I mean, you're right. The stadium situation stinks. And I know that they wanted to build a ballpark in Yorba City, but, you know, that's been stalled. You know, now they're talking about we're going to play maybe half our games in Montreal. It's like, get out of here.
Really? Yeah, no, that's
not going to break. That's not going
to
happen.
Just move the franchise to Montreal. They'll get better fans there anyway.
Yeah, but even they moved.
Yeah,
that's true.
They were in that mausoleum. You know, I mean, it's one of those things where I think like people are like pining to get the Expos back, but that's because they figured out what they lost.
Sure. Steve, one of the things, sports cliches that causes me to laugh, and it usually happens with the Pittsburgh Steelers because their fan base is really passionate. And they pack visiting stadiums. And so the announcers will say, well, you know, the Steelers, their fans really travel well. The answer is no, they don't. There's not a lot of people leaving Pittsburgh going to Miami to play the Dolphins. There's just a lot of former Pittsburghers who happen to live in Florida, and they'll travel a short distance to see their favorite team. Same with when they're out in California, the Steelers. Not a lot of Pittsburghers out in the West Coast traveling.
You're absolutely right about that. But you know what's really interesting? It's been an interesting trend of late in recent years is that you've got a lot of fans who sell their tickets. They buy the tickets. They get the season ticket package, and they sell them. Okay, so now you sell the tickets. And I was talking with Mark Vandermeer. And Mark, I've known Mark for 25 years, and he's the play-by-play voice of the Houston Texans. And Mark actually started his career here in State College, about as nice a guy as you'd ever want to meet, okay? And he's a terrific, terrific announcer, great play-by-play guy. He was doing a Texans-Cowboys game, and he was telling me there were this in Arlington, and there were more Texans fans than Cowboy fans.
Yeah. I can believe that because, you know, those tickets for the Cowboys at their billion-dollar stadium are rather salty. So people buy them, but they want to sell them and make a few extra bucks.
And that's, you know, and that's what I find interesting. People have been so willing, and it gets to the point in college stadiums. I'll never forget Nebraska, which they have. Nebraska may be middle of the road in football right now. You know, I know a lot of people are hoping and aching they get back. I think Scott Frost is a very good coach, and if anybody can get them back, it would be him. I think he's a very good coach. But you can't will a team back to prominence. It's going to take time. But they have a great fan base. And years ago, they played Notre Dame in South Bend, and they overran the stadium to the point where now it started becoming, hey, look, guys, hey, we're teams in college even, were encouraging their fans, don't sell your tickets, okay? Don't sell your tickets. Don't do that. Don't have them overrun our stadium too. And there are colleges, universities that get concerned about it. Right now there are other bigger concerns than that, as we all know. But
thank you, Ticketmaster. And the other websites that you can go and get. And I'm hoping that there'll be a Penn State at Nebraska game coming up this fall. And
it'll be at Nebraska.
Yes, and I'm always wanted to go to Nebraska to see a game because I hear that they are some of the best fans in all of college football.
When the opposing team, win or lose, exits the stadium, and from my vantage point, the press box, it's the tunnel to my left. Okay? Be the same in Beaver Stadium. In other words, the opposing team comes out of that northwest tunnel. Same story in Nebraska. They come out of the northwest tunnel. When they're exiting the game, win or lose, the fans over that tunnel give the opposing team a standing ovation. We'll come back. Yeah, isn't that cool?
That is so classy.
We'll come back with more in a moment here on News Radio 1070 WKOK, brought to you by Purdy Insurance. When it comes to car buying, there's the other guy's way, and then there's the SMC way. The other guys force you into a vehicle you really don't want. The Sunbury Motors way lets you take the time you need to browse, ask questions, and take the test drive and think on it. For over 100 years, the Mertz family and all their employees have made your experience the most pleasant one you'll ever have. The other guys won't offer you the best price for your trade, no matter how much they say they will. The SMC way is their promise to provide you with the most money the market shows your vehicle is worth. The SMC way is to offer you all applicable factory rebates on new vehicles and generous discounts. Looking for a pre-owned vehicle? The SMC Way checks each vehicle in a 200-mile radius to determine the lowest price, then beat it. It's the lowest price promise, just part of the SMC Way. The choice is up to you. The other guy's way or the SMC Way. The SMC Way wins every time. Sunbury Motors Company in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury, and at sunburymotors.com. Selling more cars and satisfying more customers for over 100 years. RJ Anderson, CBS Sports, next half hour on Major League Baseball. And where everything stands right now. Great to have you with us on the show today. Brought to you by Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. And believe me, you call, and they've got somebody there. You know, and auto, home, life, business, bundles, whatever it may be. They're the best in the insurance business. They always find you the best price whenever possible. And the customer service means everything to them. Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. And we're in the Sunbury Motors studio, Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Service department open 7 to 4 Monday through Friday. They do great work there. And then don't forget, go to the website where you can research vehicles as well. Again, RJ Anderson, next half hour on Major League Baseball. Certain things I want to get into. moving forward, what could this mean about the draft, the minor leagues, what we're learning from the KBO, which is the Korean Baseball Organization. We're going to talk to him about all that and more in the next half hour with R.J. Anderson, who's been a great resource and guest on the show. I'm not going to bring up the just despicable comments Matt made about the Marlins. I mean, it's just...
Well, that's low on the totem pole anyway of what's going on right now. But I'm only going by what I'm seeing. I'm
mum's
just giving my honest
opinion. On those comments. Our lips are sealed.
Oh, it's brutal. I mean, when Matt gets going.
Matt was fired up.
I mean, when it comes to an issue, and I put like a piece of paper up there, here's the issue. He takes a machete and slices and dices the paper.
No, he set it on fire.
I mean,
jeez,
my
goodness. He burned it.
I mean, Bob.
Oh, Steve, I tell you, ignited his passion there for a bit.
He's so temperamental.
Oh. Yeah, but he's on the board today, controlling all of what we say and do.
And he's forcing the kid to be an Eagles fan. Let the kid make a choice.
He got him all kinds of Eagles clothing already. The kid's in his Eagles T-shirt.
And teaching him the Eagles fight song as well.
Well, that won't take long.
Boy, I bet Lisa sits there every night and just shakes her head and cringes.
Yeah.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. And yes, the Purdy offices are manned, so you can get a hold of them, whether by phone or by, of course, the website. And they're the best in the insurance business. They'll find you the exact insurance you need. Yeah, it could be auto, home, life, business, maybe a bundle. And they'll find you the best price where applicable. Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. We're in the Sunbury Motors studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sunbury Motors Service Department open Monday through Friday, 7 a.m. to 4 p.m. That's 7 a.m. to 4 p.m. They do great work. They find the problem and take care of the problem. And they do it as well as anybody in the business. And on top of it, when it comes to vehicles, go to the website. Do some research there. Yeah, and... So that's Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. We'll get a hold of R.J. Anderson in just a few minutes here and talk with him. Bob Buhner's in the house.
Glad to be here.
Great to have you here. We were talking earlier. It may not be now, but let's see how the next year goes financially and what that means for other sports outside of certain sports that obviously, you know, look, I mean, every sport generates some revenue along the way. So saying they're not revenue producing sports, yeah, they produce revenue. The problem is operating at a deficit. Well, football and men's basketball operate in the black. The other sports operate in the red. So the ones that operate in the red, is there enough on the balance sheet in football and men's basketball to then justify keeping as many sports as you have? As I've pointed out, Clemson, for example, obviously they've had great success in football. They've certainly made money for the ACC in football. Although in the 2018 National Championships, they did not sell out their stadium once in seven games, which is amazing. But the ACC has a good contract for football and men's basketball, and despite everything Clemson's done, they still drop men's and women's swimming.
You know, Steve, it's just not in the college realm, this fiscal crisis for lesser known sports than the major professional sports here in the USA. For example, USA Rugby, which has done really well on the world stage.
They're broke.
They filed bankruptcy. And the strongest rugby, they're called rugby unions, around the world, New Zealand, which is the multiple-time world champions, are in desperate straits as well. And so if it's rugby, then you got to think about what about USA Gymnastics, because they can't have their national open meet, which gets a lot of attendance and, you know, good ticket prices. So there's lots of sports like that that are, I think, really on the bubble.
Well, and that's... So we're going to have to see how this all plays out. Now, the NBA, you've heard some rumblings the NBA may not go this summer. There are a couple of issues with that. Number one, they're trying to work out with the Players Association that if they do play and it's a playoff, what's the compensation? Okay, that's a big issue. Number two, if you are the NBA or the NHL, here's something that you do need to be wary of. How deep into, if you can somehow get going, how deep into the summer do you go? Because you do have to start your next season.
Oh, exactly. September, the NBA is back in town with a bit of a preseason and training camps, and then, you know, the regular season in October.
Well, actually, the NHL goes early. The NHL goes in September. They go in September. The NBA goes in early October. That's why you notice that the NBA's played fewer games than the NHL.
Mm-hmm.
So this is it brings up interesting questions for them. If you do play, say the door's open to playing. And again, we're trying to give you the optimistic viewpoint here, just so everyone understands, because we're not, you know, nobody knows what's going to happen. But say you do play, or have the window to play. Let me phrase that differently. You have the window to play. You do at least have a chance of recouping some money from ESPN and TNT, or in the NHL's case, NBC. You do have a chance to at least get something. Now, is it enough for the balance sheet? I don't know.
One of the collective bargaining agreements, and I can't remember if it's the NHL or NBA, has a clause in it known as a force majeure, which is French for a major catastrophe. And this certainly, this pandemic would certainly qualify, which allows the which sport again? I can't remember. It's one of the two, to really break the contract and say, oops, starting over. And the Players Association, you know, is obviously very concerned about it. And on the other hand, the owners don't want to necessarily get to that point. They want to keep good labor relations. So there's a bit of a waltz going on between the players and the owners on that.
Well, part of the waltz, okay, when it comes to insurance companies, is does it spell out pandemic?
Exactly.
No, I'm not. I'm not kidding. That was not meant to be a smart aleck comment.
No, it's, you're exactly right, Steve. It's it's a unforeseen thing when some lawyers are sitting in their office drafting these kinds of contracts. Let's just see, earthquake. Okay, got that from the San Francisco Giants in the World Series. Put that in there. Tornadoes and hurricanes. Okay,
right.
Put that
hurricane,
in there.
Hurricane, tornadoes, earthquakes, things like that.
You pandemic, know. Not so much.
Right. And there's a lot of insurance. You know, again, we're sponsored by Purdy Insurance today.
Yeah, exactly.
Right. But sometimes on these insurance contracts, if that's not spelled out in there, they may not be liable to pay.
And Steve, those, as you know, and I think our listeners would know this as well, it's not like replacing a fender when you had a fender bender accident. We're talking hundreds of millions of dollars on the table.
Well, let's get to the NCAA. That basketball contract is between $800 million and $1 billion. Okay, it's right there. That's for a year.
Right.
So when they're talking about getting $270 million to distribute, now the distribution number, by the way, is about $600 million. That's the distribution
right.
number. When that distribution number is not 600 million, it's 270. And that's over 353 teams. And it's not spread out evenly.
No.
All right? There's 32 conferences. It is not spread out evenly. The Big Ten is not going to get the same cut as the Patriot League. It's not the way it works. But it still means that each athletic department knows they're going to be getting less. And that then brings, not immediately, because most athletic departments, even though they're you know, essentially nonprofits, right? That do at least put, and I've talked about this, how many times have you heard me use the words rainy day fund when we talk about the budget numbers?
This
is what we're seeing right now, for example, from Penn State, the what I refer to, it's not, it may seem like a big number to you, but it's not, you know, to the average fan, but it's not. It's not a big number. I mean, it's a number to get by short term, so that helps. But now we're talking long term here. Long term, some decisions may have to be made by some athletic departments as to how big they are moving forward. And it's just something to think about and consider. It's not something that's going to happen immediately.
Right.
Maybe we get through this period of time, and there's no need to make a move on anything, and we're fortunate about it. You know, my biggest concern is not for the sports themselves; it's for the student athletes and the opportunities.
Absolutely, but you know, Steve, one of the other to look at a worst case scenario, the insurance companies. I don't think when they assess risk, which is what insurance companies do,
sure.
I don't think they've been able to assess a worldwide pandemic because, and here's what I mean by that.
Right.
The insurance companies that the NCAA would go to buy their insurance, let's just say it's $500 million is the value of the insurance if the NCAA basketball tournament does not occur. Well, that insurance company goes to...
It ended up being $250,
okay.
But that's all right.
$250 million. A million here, a million there. And they take it to Lloyd's of London, which offers what is called reinsurance. And so
right.
that they spread the risk out to insurance companies literally around the planet. Well, guess what? This pandemic is around the planet.
Right.
And so... you wonder how much, and insurance companies do not have money set aside to cover every single risk they insure. They only have enough money to cover a percentage under the theory nothing will ever happen when you need 100% of all the risk you've insured. Well, guess what? This is uncharted territory for insurance companies. So will the NCAA get their $250 million if they are successful with their claim? How much money is in the bank?
No, they'll get it. No, they. My understanding is they're going to get it. But here, the last worldwide pandemic, I guess we would reference historically as the Spanish flu of 1917-18, right?
Major league time, absolutely.
Yeah. So let's take life back to 1917-18. Number one, there's no television. Okay? So that means there are no TV contracts. There's no radio. Hey, radio, right? Radio doesn't get going until what, 1920-21?
KDKA in Pittsburgh.
Right. So you don't have that. Now they're playing games. Well, there's no NFL in 1917 or 18. The NFL doesn't start playing until 1920. You don't have the NBA. I mean, you're decades away from that beginning. You don't have, you have college basketball, but it's recreational on campus. You have college football, but it's recreational on campus. I mean, yeah, you're playing other teams. I mean, Penn State in 19. You know, I think Hugo Bezdek was the head coach. I mean, Penn State had, you know, Hollenbeck had taken them to the 1911 and 12 mythical national championships and had undefeated teams. So, I mean, it was a little bit more than just recreational, but it's not like it is today. Same thing with college basketball, not like it is today. They had college baseball, You don't have the NHL. I mean, you don't have really technically don't have the NHL at this point. I mean, the New York Rangers didn't start playing until 1926, as an example. So you've got mostly Canadian teams playing at this time. So you don't have what you have today. Right? So the thought back then of the last worldwide pandemic doesn't have the effect on sports. I mean, the World Series in 1918, which the Red Sox won over the Cubs, I believe, okay, is played in early September. But why is it played in early September? Because of World War One.
That's right.
So you had the Spanish flu, and World War One's part of the problem with the Spanish flu. You had a lot of soldiers coming back from Europe, for example, that went to Philadelphia, and Philadelphia got just actually hammered with this. And the U.S. government, by the way, didn't tell anybody about the extent of the problem with the Spanish flu in Europe. So there's a lot. In, from the last, so 102 years ago, you have your last pandemic, essentially,
yep.
worldwide, and there's nowhere near what we're talking about and dealing with as we have today. Right?
That's exactly right, Steve. So I mean, we're so all on uncharted territory.
Right. So how's an insurance company going to deal with that? Well, back in 1917 and 18, deal with what?
Yep.
You know, you go 102 years, you don't sit there and say, hey, by the way, I'd like to insure myself against a pandemic. Okay.
Yep.
It's been 102 years. What the heck? Yeah.
Yep. Well, sign you up.
Unreal.
It is. It really is. Steve, one thing I wanted to say before we're about ready to wrap up our wonderful afternoon of sports is the passing of an NFL legend, Tom Dempsey. 73 years old.
Yeah, actually, there's two of them I want to talk about. Tom Dempsey, who, of course, kicked the 63-yard field goal to beat the Lions 1917 in Tulane Stadium in 1970.
Yep.
And he also kicked for the Philadelphia Eagles.
11 years, five teams, yep. I believe.
Yep. Arm, of course, not fully formed, half a foot, and he put together an 11-year NFL career. My understanding is that he had dementia.
Yes.
And was in a nursing home down in New Orleans and passed away. He overcame a lot of obstacles to have a successful career.
I'm surprised no one made a movie out of his life story because it is a compelling one if there ever was.
Maybe he didn't want to.
Could be.
You never know. Sometimes you get approached, I don't want to do that. You don't know. And then the other one is actually the passing of Bobby Mitchell.
Oh, my gosh, yeah.
What a great, great football player Bobby Mitchell was. Bobby Mitchell was with the Cleveland Browns, and he was in the same backfield with Jim Brown. Now, even in being in the same backfield with Jim Brown, he was over 500 yards rushing in three straight years. Being in the same backfield with Jim Brown, who, by the way, got the majority of the carries. He then gets traded to the Redskins for Ernie Davis. See, people forget Ernie Davis was not drafted by the Cleveland Browns. He was drafted by the Redskins, and they dealt him to the Browns. Never played a game for the Browns because they then discovered he had leukemia. And Bobby Mitchell is the one that broke the barrier in Washington. He was the first African-American player. So Bobby Mitchell, it's 1961. The Redskins are the last NFL team to, quote, integrate. So he has to not only go in there, but he has to go in there and be not just, he has to be perfect on and off the field, and he's got to be great. And it turns out he was. They moved him from halfback, using the 1960s terms, to flanker. And in three straight years, with Sonny Jurgensen as his quarterback, he had three straight 1,300-yard receiving seasons. Now, in time, the Redskins then really started in. Charlie Taylor came in. I mean, you know, and the Redskins had in the 60s had a dynamic offense. And Bobby Mitchell NFL Hall of Famer, big reason why, and was with the Redskins organization in the front office for over 30 years. A Pro Football Hall of Famer, number 49. He was a great, great player.
Steve, I read a really funny story about Bobby Mitchell when he was with the Browns and playing in the same backfield as Jim Brown. It seemed that Paul Brown, the legendary coach of the Browns, whenever there was a problem, like, for example, if Jim Brown and Bobby Mitchell would be 10 minutes late for the bus, he'd be standing at the front door of the bus and, "Mitchell, I can't believe you didn't show up on time." Never said a word to Jim Brown.
Well, that goes back to the old Jerry Tarkanian line. The NCAA is so upset at Kentucky, they put Wichita State on probation. We'll come back. We'll wrap it up in a moment on News Radio 1070 WKOK, brought to you by Purdy Insurance.
Continue to listen to the recommendations from federal, state, and local experts, including the Center for Disease Control, concerning efforts to limit the spread of coronavirus. During this time, our office remains operational and available to service our current and new clients. Our employees will be available by phone at 570-286-5855, as well as email, and have access to our systems to continue to conduct business. Please know that our after-hours emergency service will continue to be available. Based on the recommendations from federal, state, and local experts, our building will be closed to the public during these extraordinary times. Our employees will be working from home to practice social distancing so we can do our part to keep our staff and community as safe and healthy as possible. Please be advised that all face-to-face meetings will be discontinued in favor of conducting business via phone or email. At this time, we ask that you be safe, be well, and be kind, and know that your Purdy Insurance team is committed to the highest levels of service and is only a phone call away.
All right, Purdy Insurance, don't go into the office, but you can get a hold of them on the phone, and you can email them. There's always the website, so Purdy Insurance is there for you. Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Sunbury Motors, their service department, open Monday through Friday, 7 to 4. All right, Monday through Friday, 7 to 4, and use their website to research the vehicle of your dreams. All right, closing up shop for today. We had a problem getting R.J. Anderson on. We're going to get him on later in the week. We're going to talk baseball with him. He wants to come on, so this is not... I mean, he wants to be on. Stephen Gonzalez, the former Nittany Lion, on the show tomorrow. And Cindy Bourne, Washington Post, tomorrow as well. And later in the week, Stefan Wisniewski. Bob, thank you so much.
You're welcome, Steve.
Matt, I feel badly about bringing up the Marlins because, again, I mean, seeing you tilt toward anger management.
Struck a nerve.
I mean, it's just, I mean, I don't know. I'm getting concerned. I didn't think bringing up the Marlins would just bring this amount of venom out of you.
Who knew?
I mean, I thought bringing up the Washington Nationals would.